Hey everyone, I hope you had a great day. In this video, we are looking at some new r/malicious compliance stories. I hope you enjoy them. The first story is called, Don't Train Me for My Job. This was years ago. I was working out of a mobile facility compound. Think metal boxes for workspaces that are easy to transport and rearrange as needed. The area had lots of humidity and it rained a lot. So they had the tendency to rust and it bled through the paint on a majority of the units. My manager tells me that he has a project for me. He leads me outside and points at the rust. He says he wants the mobile facilities to look white. I had no clue about corrosion control or busting rust, as they say. So I proceeded to ask him how I go about that. He shouts that he doesn't care how I do it, just to make them right. Roger that. I go check out 3 cans of white polyurethane spray paint and spray over all the rust. About an hour later, I come in and tell my manager that I'm finished. He doesn't believe me and heads outside to look over my work. He then yells at me that all I did was paint over the rust. Then tells me that he can still see the blister and breaks in the original paint job. I smile at him and remind him that he wanted them right and he didn't care how it was done. I can see the look on his face of instant regret for what he had said about the job. We head back inside. I hear him yelling at my supervisor about how much of an idiot I am and to make sure I understand what it is I am supposed to do. My supervisor pulls up the manuals and tells me to read up and learn the books. We then head over to check out equipment and he shows me what I am to do. After that they left me alone and I pretty much reported twice a day and had my own work schedule and did my own thing for 6 months busting rust. Unfortunate that he needed to maliciously comply to get the training he needed, but at least it worked. The next story is called Glitter is Life. This was 10 years or so ago. I was in remedial math. I am horrible at mathematics and I knew it. My teacher was, frankly, a jerk. He screamed at us, openly called students stupid, wouldn't let anyone go to the bathroom or get water, and the list goes on. Well, our final project came. We had to make a poster with 3D shapes and their formulas. Preferably, it would be attractive and he said he would hang them in the classroom. Unlike most of my teachers, he did not say a word about the usage of glitter. Well, I happen to love glitter, any color. And I had a hot pink poster board. When I was done, literally everything on the poster except for the formulas was coated in a thick layer of glitter. My teacher lost it. He yelled and asked why I got his room covered in glitter. I informed him that he said it had to be attractive and I love pink glitter, didn't he? He just stared at me in disbelief. I was a goth kid. I grinned at him. He demanded to know, where are your formulas? I pointed them out. They were written in neon green. He glared and for the next 3 weeks he had to look at my eyesore for project. Glitter is life. The third story is called Never Do That Again. As a teenager, I got hired at a local pizzeria as a delivery driver. My job description was literally pick up pizzas from the store and drive them to customers. As it normally goes at these smaller shops though, I started picking up more and more jobs from prepping ingredients to washing dishes and making pizzas. By the time I was 6 months into the job, I was also handling scheduling, some payroll and was the evening shift lead. All this extra work, of course, came with no extra compensation. One day, when making marinara sauce for our pasta, I added plain water to the pot as per instructions. The owner's wife, upon seeing this, became extremely angry and whacked me on the head with a spoon. She then added meatball water to the marinara sauce that we were advertising as vegetarian. She then yelled at me, "Don't ever do that again. Why are you wasting water when there's water with more flavor in it right there?" Obviously, I wasn't going to stand for being hit. So I decided to take some petty revenge before I left. The next time the owner's wife told me to make the sauce, I simply said, "You told me to never do that again." So I am going to go finish the next 2 weeks of scheduling in the back. Where did I go? Out the back door, never to be seen in that place again. Without someone there that they could underpay to do the manager's work, the lazy manager had to figure out how to do it all himself. He never figured out how, schedule didn't go out in time, people's check got delayed and half the staff quit. The pizza shop is now closed. The next story is called Pull Everything. I work at a place that farms a certain type of animal used in research. These animals live lives of luxury. But every once in a while, they get hurt due to fighting amongst themselves or being the curious species that they are. This farm has its own vet clinic with a couple of rats and a few rat techs. My job. We start each morning with a meeting in which we go over our game plan for the day. After the meeting, we begin with pulling the animals observed the day before that may require a health check that are non-emergent cases. Our rule of thumb is that if it's not something we would personally go to the hospital or doctor for, we would just continue to monitor the animal. Or we would schedule it for a pull the next morning and do an exam. This particular morning meeting, one of the higher up rats was laying into us about pulling any and everything we see right when we see it. Some of the other rat techs were asking for clarity on this demand, but was mad with the vet just repeating the words pull everything the day off. So we left the meeting and went on to our daily duties. It was as if everyone had the same maliciously compliant idea all at once. We pulled everything. Small and almost healed scratches. This animal looked a little down. This animal wasn't eating in the 5 minutes I was looking at it. By noon, all of the clinics were overflowing with patients. The vet that made the demand was sent the majority of the cases and seemed very distressed. He even called a few techs into the clinic to return the animals before they were checked. The next morning, we got a lecture about using discretion. And that if the animal is not in distress and it is not one of the emergent cases, please use the pull board to pull the next day. One of the techs that brought in the most animals the day prior said, "So, you want us to do what we were already doing prior to your lecture yesterday?" I wanted to add that I wasn't directly involved in this malicious compliance as I was still in training and therefore not qualified to make the official call to pull the animal. But I did help find the tiniest of scratches and reported them to my trainer. I'm also adding that the quality of care for the animals that truly needed care was not compromised with our antics. The majority of the pulls everyone made were useless pulls and they were allowed to return to their groups almost immediately. The last story is called Team Mentality. In high school in the mid to late 90s, I worked at Target. At the time, and possibly still today, I don't actually know, Target divided their departments into hard lines and soft lines. Soft lines is basically all the clothes and apparel type departments, and hard lines was everything else. Hard lines was further divided into A and B, with one being the home goods type stuff like chintzy decoratives, soaps and cleaning supplies, and the other basically toys, hardware and electronics. Target pushed the team culture to an obsessive degree, and the store managers were zealots, except for when it came time to close. Often, the store was trashed, and the closing staff had to keep working well past closing to get the store into a proper state, with hardlines often hurting the most and toys absolutely the worst. Basically, everyone had to stay and fix the shelves till it was done, your department or not. But this rule didn't apply to the soft lines or the cashiers. They left whenever they were done. Usually around 10:30 PM. Hardlines was often there till 1 AM during holidays, but there was occasionally a closing sale and softlines was equally a mess. Hardlines were always required to help softlines because that's the team method. Softlines managers, on the other hand, would refuse to assist hardlines ever, despite the team rules. I was in hardlines and suffering in school because of the late nights. I told my managers I needed to be leaving when my shift ended, without exceptions. They refused because this wasn't teamwork speak and told me that if I wanted to keep my job, that I would go home when my department goes home. So I transferred and started taking softline shifts instead. 10 PM rolls around, one big sale day for hardware, and softlines is done and picking up by 10:15. I go up to clock out and am told that the store leader, who is also the hardlines manager, is calling on the radio for me to go help sort the shelves. I responded that my department is done and that he told me that I leave when my department is done, went home and went to sleep. I still failed 2 morning classes though, because the damage had been done. Moral of the story? Don't work too close at Target if you care about your grades. Is this still a thing at Target? Or was this just the individual store? Thanks for watching, I hope you enjoyed the video. And now, I hope you have a great day. See you soon, bye bye.